Good evening. Hope all of you are doing well. Tonight we're learning Maseches Eruvin, Daf Ayin Aleph, and starting on the very bottom line of Daf Ayin Amud Beis, actually two lines from the bottom, at Toshma. At just a little bit of a starting point, which we have to bridge from yesterday, is that on the top of Ayin Amud Beis, we saw Machlokas Amoraim about whether or not a Yoresh, a child, is allowed to be Mevatel. So if you look on just the fifth line of the page, Amar Le, Rav Nachman said, Ani Omer Mevatel, that the Yoresh is allowed to do bittul. That's a din that we saw, that if God forbid, if someone's parent passes away at 120, the son can do bittul right away on Shabbos, no problem. And we saw the language of the Gemara that it's kikare aviv. It's basically like the part of the body of the father. He's just it's all one in the same family. So on that, we're going to ask a question. However, it seems that the question that we're going to be asking is out of left field. And here's the question that's out of left field. Two lines from the bottom, ayin amud beis. Toshma, Yisrael, the ger, if you have a Jew, a full-fledged Jew who's born that way, and a ger, someone who is a ger, and the need to speak about a ger is because this ger has no yorshim, right? We know that nichse hager is its own animal in halacha. This is probably the third or fourth time in Shas that we've come across the sugya of nichse hager, and we know that a ger has no family members, and by definition, his nechasim can be picked up by other people. So here's the case. Yisrael v'ger, shirin b'megura. They live in a megura. What's a megura? Rashi, two lines from the bottom. Rashi, dibur hamaschil megura. Rashi says, gorenhu. It's like a storage house. V'chaluk b'chadarim. And it has a lot of different rooms. V'haya l'chol echad pischo b'chatzer. V'osrin zelze. And everyone has their own entrance into the chatzer. And therefore, the ger and the Yisrael, who live in this particular megura, they are osir on one another if they don't make an eru. So then what's the case here? The case is, what happens if umeis hager, or on the bottom line of ayin amud beis? So if the ger dies, then what happens to the fact that they now have nichsei hager? Who's going to chop up the nichsei hager, and will it cause a problem for the eruv? Now remember that we're going to be asking a question about a yerusha. Are the nichsei hager similar to the case of yerusha? Right? Think about it this way. The father and the son, the ger and the person who takes his nechasim. Are those cases comparable? So it says Tosfos on the bottom line of Ayin Amud Beis and Tosfos, Dibra Maschil Toshma Yisrael, Kasavar Rava. Rava was of the opinion, Demikoach HaGer Chashiv Kemo Yoresh. A fascinating comparison, seemingly a little off the beaten path. But Tosfos, quoting Rava, says that yes, we have a comparison from the case of Ger and his Nechasim to a case of a Yoresh, to have a Kari Deavua, to Ilav Achi Lo Kashemidi Le Rav Yochanan, Le Rav Nachman, excuse me. The assumption of the Gemara, says Tosfos, based on Rava, asking against Rav Nachman, is that it must be that the Gemara, that Rava understood that the Nechasim of the Ger is similar enough to the case of a Yoresh that we can ask a question against Rav Nachman. Now, we're not going to see the question on Rav Nachman for about 15 lines. It'll be almost halfway down an ayin aleph. So let's analyze this case. This is a brisa, and again, a case of Yisrael and a ger, and they're living in a place where there needed to be an eruv, but there wasn't one, and the ger passes away. So mi ba'od yom, if he dies before Shabbos starts, then afal pi shehichzik Yisrael acher b'nechasav, even though another Jew, not the Jew that's living inside the chatzer, but a Jew outside the chatzer, and he says, I'm koned the nechasim of the ger who just died, so then oser. He creates a problem because he's now an owner of the nechasim of the ger. So the Jew outside the chatzer is osir on the Jew inside the chatzer, because the Jew outside the chatzer was called kona the nechasim of the ger. And now we have two people, effectively, who live in that space. One lives in one part of the megura. Now he's a full Yisrael. One is another part, and they're osir on each other. That's the first half of this brisa, is if the ger dies before Shabbos. However, Mishecha Shecha, if he dies after dark, then Afal Pisha Lo Hechzik Yisrael Acher, even if nobody were to be Kona the Nechasim, Eino Oser, there would be no problem at all with the Yisrael who lives in the Chatzer, who lives inside the Megura for him to carry. Rashi, second line of Rashi, Dibur Hamaschil Mishecha Shecha, because of a principle that we already learned. And what's the principle that we already learned? Shekvar Kona Eruv. Once the Eruv was kona by Shkia, then even if it gets eaten, even if the person dies, doesn't make a difference. They can still rely on the Eruv throughout the entire Shabbos. That's totally fine. So that's why this Brisa, according to this approach, makes the distinction between whether or not the Ger died before Shkia versus whether or not the ger died after shkia. But the problem with this brisa, and the brisa is over now, we're on line 3 on ayin aleph amid aleph. The problem with this brisa is the language of afalpi. So let's say I was inviting someone to a party, and you said, Phil, can I come? And I would say, even you can come. So what does the word even mean? So other people for sure can come. Even you, you're the chiddush. So when there's an afalpi, then there's something else that's pashut. That's whenever we say, even you can come, so you're the chiddush, something else was obvious. So these afalpis don't actually make so much sense, says the Gemara. Ha gufa kasha, third line. Amris, what was the first part of the brisa that you said? The ger died. And we said, if he died mi be'od yom, afalpi shehichzik, even though you made a chazaka. Says the Gemara, what would be the diuk there? The lomi boya, what's the obvious? It's obvious, ki lo hichzik, had there not been a chazaka, that we would have said that you're oser. Says the Gemara, that diuk doesn't work. Because if that were true, then adiraba, ki lo hichzik lo asar. If someone didn't make a kinyan on the nichse hager, then it should not have been problematic for the Eruv in that space. So how did you use the language of afalpi? That's what the question is of the Gemara, is that in the first part of the Brisa, this is the top line of Ayin Aleph Amin Aleph, it says, afalpi shechzik yisrael b'acher b'nechasev oser. What's afalpi? The afalpi is the chiddush. It implies that the obvious part is that even had he not been, and that's not correct. So it says the Gemara, Amara Papa, fifth line, you're correct. Ema, what should the Brisa have said? Ema, afal pi shelo hichzik. It should have said, even though he wasn't Kona from before Shabbos, so still it's going to be Oser. And of course, if he was Kona, that makes more sense. But says the Gemara, Rav Papa, your answer is nice, but not every time that you want to change the words in a Brisa does it work. Veha, afal pi shichzik tani. We have the Brisa in front of us. Doesn't seem to be any scratch outs. You can't just change the language whenever you want. There needs to be a context. So it says, Rapapa, give me a chance. Let me explain to you what I'm talking about. It says the Gemara as follows. What's pshat here? Hachik tani, or hachik amar. Afal pi shelo hichzik mi be'od yom, ela mishecha shecha. Even though is on the timing of day. It's not on the whether or not there was a kinyan. Afal pi shelo hichzik mi be'od yom. Even though the ger died before Shabbos, even though you were not making the kinyan before Shabbos, when he died, but but you only made the kinyan after Shabbos started. So he died at 5 o'clock and Shki was at 6 and you made the kinyan at 7. So says the Gemara, but since he did die before Shabbos, so the afal pi is that afal pi that you did not make the kinyan before Shabbos, what's the obvious case? Of course, if you made the kinyan on Shabbos, it would be oser. But certainly, even if you made it before, it would be oser because he had died before Shabbos. However, and now we have to analyze the second part of the brisa. Now we're 8 lines down. Says the Gemara as follows: Mishecha Shecha, the brisa wrote that if he died after dark, then afal pi shelo hichzik Yisrael acher eino oser. That even though it was not acquired, the nichse hager was not acquired by another Jew eino oser. That there's no prohibition on the eruv. So says the Gemara, what does that afal pi mean? Because if that afal pi is true, then afal pi shelo hichzik Yisrael acher v'lo mibaya ki hichzik. It sounds like it's almost what's the obvious? If the afalpi, if the chiddush is when he's not going to make a chazaka, when the person's not going to be kona the nechse hager, then it seems obvious. But of course, had he been kona the nechse hager, velomi boya ki hichzik, then of course it would not be usher. Says Gemara, that makes no sense because adiraba ki hichzik usher. So we're analyzing both parts of the Mishnah to say that the language of afalpi, the chiddush language, is backwards. The implications of afalpi don't work. And therefore, again, Amar Rav Papa, we're about a quarter of the way down, a fifth of the way down. Amar Rav Papa, Ema, what should the Brisa have said? Afal pi shehichzik. Here again, the Gemara says, fine, the answer would make sense. It would make sense on paper. But again, afal pi shehichzik tani. The Brisa is in front of me. You can't just change the text whenever you want. So again, says the Gemara in the name of Rav Papa, Hachi ka Amar. And here is how we understand the second part of the Brisa. Afal pi shehichzik mishecha shecha, even though the Yisrael made a kinyan after it was already dark, and he died after dark. Since the person didn't die before Shabbos, he only died after Shabbos started. So then, namely, Shabbos started with a kinyan shvisa. Shabbos started with an eruv. The fact that he died at 6:01 after Shabbos started, so okay, now there's an eruv. You cannot be oser in this case. Even if you try to make a kinyan on the next day, Agar, it won't undo the eruv. The Erev is good. So this is the Brisa that we learned. Now here's the diuk of the Brisa. Remember where we started, that we're asking a question on Rav Nachman, because Rav Nachman said that a Yoresh can be Mevatel. that a child of someone who passes away, he's able to do bittles. That's the Gemara, Ketani Mihas Resha. What did we see in the beginning of this case, in the first half of this Braisa about the Nichsei Hager? Oser. We see there, not that you can do bittle, but that it's Oser. Kashan Rav Nachman. Rav Nachman, you said that the Yorish was allowed to be Mavatel. Yet we see in this case of the Ger, the person who's being Kona, the Nichsei Hager, that he can't be Mavatel. He can only be, it's just going to be Oser. But why not do bittle? So therefore, Rav Nachman, we have a brisa that's against you. So it says the Gemara, one third of the way down, am I Aser, Nivtel? Why should it be that it's Aser in the case of the Nechse Hager, the first half of the brisa, where he makes a kinyan before Shabbos, or even on Shabbos, provided that he died before Shabbos? Nivtel, he should be able to do Bittel. Says the Gemara, you're correct. The language of this brisa is not meant to be accurate. My Oser Nami Diktani, what does it mean that he's Oser? Ad She Yevatel. Yes, it's Oser until you do Bittel. And now we understand this Braisa to be in line with Rav Nachman. We, in fact, Paskin like Rav Nachman, that a Yoresh can do Bittel. And this Braisa that we tried to say, maybe Nichse Hager is against Rav Nachman, we end up creating that Braisa to fit with Rav Nachman instead of asking against him. One third of the way down, Ayin Aleph, Amud Aleph. Says the Gemara, Rabbi Yochanan Amar must nice some money. Who's the author of this Mishnah that we have just been learning, who makes a distinction from before Shabbos to after Shabbos? Namely, if the ger dies before Shabbos, then it would be a problem if a Yisrael's kona, the nichse hager, it would cause a problem for the other guy in the chatzer. Oh, so then who is that? Beis Shammai hi. This brisa can only be in accordance with Beis Shammai. Why? Because the Amre, what do Beis Shammai hold? Ain bittel rishus b'Shabbos, because Beis Shammai holds you cannot do bittel on Shabbos, only from before Shabbos. Ditznan, this was our Mishnah that we had on Samach Tes Amud Beis. Yep, this is the Mishnah we have on Samach Tes Amud Beis. It says there, Ditznan, me'imas I nosnin rishus. And remember, we said in our Mishnah that nosnin rishus means bittel. When is one allowed to do bittel? Beis Shammai omer mi be'od yom. Perfect. Beis Shammai is a hand to glove match to this Mishnah that we just learned, to the Braisa we just learned about Nichsei Hager. Because in the Brais of Nichsei Hager, we said that if he died before Shabbos, and then Yisrael was Kona the Nichsei Hager from outside the Chatzer, then he ruins the Chatzer for the person who lives inside. So he makes the distinction, just like Beis Shammai, Amiba Ojom, Uves Hillel Omre Mishatechshach. And Beis Hillel says that you can even make a kinyan, you can even do bittel, excuse me, once it's dark. So that's the Shita, that's how Rav Yochanan explains that this Brisa about Nichsei Hager must be within the frame of Beis Shammai. Amar Ula my time by the Beis Hillel. What's the reason why Beis Hillel says that it's allowed even on Shabbos? And the Gemara gives an answer that gets rejected. Here's the answer that gets rejected. Nase keomer kalach etzel yofos. Rashi, just to our right, up about an inch and a half, Dibur Hamaschel kalach etzel yofos. What is the case of kalach etzel yofos? It's a case where I see your tevel. I go into your field and says Rashi, gabe torim es shel chaveiro shalomidas. I am torim. I take your tevel and I do meiser for you, or I do truma gdola for you. So does that work halachically? Does that work? So it says Rashi. Rashi says gabe torim es shel chaveiro shelo midas. Tanya the brisa in Maseches Bava Metzia writes. Ba bala bayis. Let's say you come home and you see. Oh, I see it's 10% lower. Somebody tithed for me. Umitzoshu torim. You saw that I'm your good friend. I was just concerned about tevel, so I did the tithe for you. Omar lo kalach etzel yafos. Oh, I like what you did. So im yesh lo yafos mehen trumaso trum. If he's talking about it in a positive way, it's a good thing that you did what he did. De gali adaite de nichale, because you're showing that that's what you wanted. So what is Rashi basically saying here? Rashi is saying that what Beis Hillel is saying is that the reason why we allow Mishatech Shach is because it's good to have happened. We want this person to be able to do Bittel on Shabbos. So therefore, Beis Shammai allows it to happen on Shabbos. Amar Abaye, this can't be because it's good that it should happen. That's not a good argument to say that you should be allowed to do a kinyan with Mishatech HaShecha. Why not? Because Amar Abaye, Meis Nachri B'Shabbos, Mai Kalach Etzel Yafosika. What if a goy dies on Shabbos? There's nothing good about that. That's not a good thing that we can say, just like by the guy that I did the meiser for him, I was torim for him. So that worked out good because he was happy I did a mitzvah. How is that equivalent to a case of a meis dying? There's no kalach etzel yafos. There's nothing good about that case. So says the Gemara, therefore it can't be that this is the reason why Beis Hillel allows doing bittel after dark. Ella, says the Gemara, hacha behaka miflage. And here is some of the deepest lumdos of whether or not there is a kinyan by bittel. And says the Gemara as follows. Ella hacha behaka miflage. What are Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel really arguing about? The Beis Shammai, Savre Beis Shammai, was of the opinion, Bittul Rishus Mikna Rishusahu. When you're doing Bittul, there's actually a kinyan taking place. And because that's true, Umiknia Rishusa B'Shabbos Aser. But you're not allowed to make a kinyan on Shabbos. So therefore, says Beis Shammai, you're only allowed to do Bittul before Shabbos starts, because you're not allowed to do kinyanim on Shabbos. We've already seen we don't paskin like this 10 times over because you're allowed to give less than a shava pruta. There's a lot of things that you can do on Shabbos that we otherwise wouldn't allow had we lived in Beis Shammai's world of only allowing it before Shabbos. But what was Beis Shammai concerned about? A kinyan. You can't make an acquisition on Shabbos. Therefore, Beis Shammai only allowed prior to Shabbos. However, in sharp, sharp contrast to Beis Hillel, two lines before the Mishnah, Beis Hillel Savre, Istaluke Rishusa Be'alma, who know. This is just it's a removal of me from a Rishus, the Istaluke Rishusa B'Shabbos Shapir Dami. And to remove yourself from a Rishus on Shabbos, that is not a Kenyan. It's a Siluk. Maybe it's Hefker. Maybe it's a whole bunch of things, but it's not a Kenyan. It's just not a Kenyan. And that was the reason why we saw a distinction in our Mishnah between the Shitas of Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel. The Beis Hillel holds that Bittul is a form of a Kenyan, and therefore it can only be done before Shabbos and not on Shabbos. Masha'en Kein, the Shita Beis Hillel was more lenient, where no, it's just a Siluk, the Istaluke Mirushusa on Shabbos, that is Lav Milsahi, that is nothing to worry about at all, and Shapir Dami. Okay, that brings us to the Mishnah. This next Mishnah, clean, simple Mishnah. Says the Mishnah as follows. We're about two-thirds of the way down on Ayin Aleph Amud Aleph. Says the Mishnah, Bala Bayi Shaya Shutav L'Shcheinav. I live in the middle and I'm friends with my two neighbors. Lozeh B'Yayin V'Lozeh B'Yayin. I have wine at your house and I have wine at the other house. The guy to my right and the guy to my left. So what's the din, says the Mishnah? Because we're such good chaverim that we keep wine by each other, says the Gemara, Ein Tzrichen Eruv, Ein Tzrichen La'arev. We don't need to do anything else special to be ma'arev. We don't need to do anything. We're good. We can carry. We're good to go. We have our eruv chatzeros. Lozeh b'yayin v'lozeh b'shemen. But let's say my neighbor to my right, he and I have wine. We have a wine cellar and we keep it on his property. And the guy to the left, we store oil. Different business model. So then says the Gemara, there tzrichim la'arev. There we need to do an eruv. We'll see why in the Gemara. All of that is the Tanakama. In contrast with the Tanakama, Rib Shimon Omer, Echad Zeh ve'Echad Zeh, Einan Tzrichin La'arev. No, even the case where the neighbor to the right is wine and the neighbor to the left is oil, we don't care. The din is that you do not need an Eruv. It doesn't make a difference that they have different types of product. We don't care. So says the Gemara, Omar Rav. Rav says, Ubikli Echad, it must be that we're talking about where everything is in one Kli. Okay, what is that talking about? Omar Rava Dekanami, this actually makes a lot of sense. Because, says Rava, and this will get rejected, to Katani, we saw in our Mishnah, Lozeh b'yayin v'lozeh b'shemen, tzrichin le'arev. We saw that, according to the Tanakama, that if one neighbor was the neighbor with whom you had a deal with wine, and another neighbor was the neighbor with whom you had oil, there we said tzrichin le'arev. It says the Gemara as follows, Iyamris bishlama reisha b'kli echad v'seifa b'shnei kelim shapir. If you want to tell me that the Resha, it's all in one Kli, and therefore you and I are, we're two peas in a pod, and therefore I don't have to be Ma'arev, I got it. And the Seifa is Bishnei Kalim, and in the Seifa, it's in two different Kalim, and therefore, what did we say? You have to be Ma'arev. So then that makes sense. Ella, says Rava, Ella, if what you're saying is, Ella, I Amris Resha Bishnei Kalim, the Seifa Bishnei Kalim, if the Resha and Seifa are both talking about the product being in the same number of Kalim, then I don't understand, says Rava. Mali Yayin V'Yayin, Mali Yayin V'Shemen. Who cares what's in the barrels? Who cares what's in the jugs? You're my neighbor. I have wine with you. No need for Eruv. This guy has oil, so now both of you need an Eruv? That doesn't even make any sense. What does one thing have to do with the other? So Rav is very bothered by this. Obviously, it must be that the Resha is talking about where there's everything's in one Kli, and therefore you don't need an Eruv. And the Seifa is talking about where things are in two Kli, Kalim, and therefore you do need an Eruv. Says the Gemara, Amar Le Abaye, no, you're not understanding, Rava. Abaye says there's a qualitative difference between wine and oil. Yayin v'yayin ro'i la'arev. We see this all the time on our bottles, a mix of this type of wine with that type of wine, and the percentages are laid out on the bottle. We mix wines all the time to get the color, to get the flavor that we want. We do that all the time. However, yayin v'shemen ain't ro'i la'arev. No, Rava, you totally got it wrong. They have the same number of kelim. Case number one, yayin v'yayin has one kli, or two, whichever it is. But case one and case two have the same number of kelim. So why do we make a distinction that in the first case where it's yayin v'yayin, and the other guy is yayin and the other person is yayin v'shemen, why do we say in the first case that there's no need for an eruv? In the second, we do because, says the Gemara, Abaye says, because oil separates from wine. Oil is an oil base and it floats. It has less density than the wine. So you'll see a whole thick layer on the top. Therefore, says the Gemara, rejecting Rav and supporting Rav, we are always talking about a case where it is even in the same number of kelim. We're at the two dots, about 11 lines from the bottom of the page. Now we saw in our Mishnah the dissenting opinion, the shita that was against our Tanakama, and that was the shita of Rav Shimon. Rav Shimon said, Echad ze ve'echad ze in tzarech la'arev. He argued on the Mishnah, on the Tanakama, whereas the Tanakama said that if the neighbor had oil, that would not work, says Rav Shimon, yes, it will. And then says the Gemara, wait a minute. You would even say that it's true when there's different types of liquid. What about Abaye's concern that the two things don't mix properly? So says the Gemara, Rabba, can't be Rabba, because Rabba was the one who misunderstood four lines ago. Amar Rabba, hacha b'maya skinan, what are we talking about? Bechatzer shebein shnei mavuos. We're talking about a very specific case. There's an ukimta. Rav Shimon understood our Mishnah that we're talking about a chatzer that's in between two mavuos. And the Rav Shimon l'taime. Ditznan, Amar Rav Shimon, l'maha davar dome. We're going back many, many blot. We spent some time on this on Daf Mem Hei, 25 blot ago approximately. What did we learn? We learned a comparison to something in our Mishnah. We were talking about, you know, the three overlapping spaces of a person's Dalet Amos, whatever the space was for them. And the Gemara, the Mishnah there added this case, Lama Damar Doma, what is it similar to? L'shalosh chatzeros ha-psuchos u'lizu, of three chatzeros that are open to one another, and as well, u'psuchos l'reshus harabim. And there in that Mishnah, we said, how do these three chatzeros interact with each other? Irvu shtayim hachitzonos im ha'imtzayis, if the two outer ones made an eruv with the middle one, so the middle one, he mutaras imahen, the middle one is allowed to be with the outer ones, vehein mutaras ima, the outer ones can be with the middle one, however, v'shtay machitzonos asuros zuim zu, but the two outer ones are not allowed to be together. So this, says the Gemara, is Rav Shimon's comparison. So says the Gemara, you cannot compare the case of mavui chatzer mavui to three chatzeros in a row. Why not? Amar le Abaye, mi dami. These two cases are not similar. Why are these two cases not similar? Because three lines from the bottom of Ayin Aleph Amud Aleph. Hasam, over there in that Mishnah on Daf Mem Hei, Katani Shtay Machitonos Asuros Zoim Zo. What did we learn in that Mishnah, in that Mashal in the Mishnah? That the two outer Chatzeros are Asur to each other. Again, they're both Mutter to the middle one. And the middle one's Mutter to the outer ones. But the two outer ones cannot go all the way to each other's properties. However, but here, Rav Shimon, you said there was no need for an Eruv. You can't compare a case where the two outer ones are usher to each other to a case where the two outer ones are mutter to each other. There's no level playing field there. So the case on Mem Hei is not Rav Shimon Lashitaso. It's a zero. It doesn't compare to our case at all. Because over there, the two outer components, the two chatzeros, were usher to each other. But here, the two outer people are mutter to each other. It says the Gemara, no, you misunderstood. My ain tzrichin la'arev. What did Rav Shimon mean in our Mishnah when he said ain tzrichin la'arev? Not that the two outer ones are allowed to carry with each other. What does he mean ain tzrichin la'arev? Shcheinim bahadei balabayis. Between the two outer people and the middle person, that's where we say that there is no need for an eruv. However, aval shcheinim bahadei hadadei, the two outer people, no. Tzrichin la'arev, and therefore Rav Shimon is perfect. Rav Shimon is kaftor b'ferach, because the case on Daf Mem Hein, the Mishnah, was three chatzer, the two outer ones are usher to each other. And the way he just explained our Mishnah, here too, it's also the same thing. The two outer ones are not allowed to be with each other. What does the Mishnah mean when it says ein tzarech la'arev? That's the two outer ones with the middle person, but not with each other. And therefore Rav Shimon is lishitaso and very, very clear. Turning to the top of Daf Ayin Aleph, Amar Aleph, we're going to go until about eight lines from the bottom of the page. Rav Yosef Amar, Rav Yosef says, We asked a question over here on the bottom of the page by Reb Shimon. Reb Shimon, we asked against him, what about yayin and oil? How can you say that there's no Eruv needed there? So says the Gemara on the top of Ayin Aleph, Amud Aleph, our second approach for Rav Yosef Omar, Reb Shimon v'Rabbanon, v'plugta de Rav Yochanan v'nur v'Rabbanon k'miflege. Yeah, a little bit of basic science. We know that oil floats, and that will help, well, oil's less dense, and therefore this will hopefully be a very clean understanding of our Machlokas and our Mishnah. Here we go. It's not. The Mishnah writes, Shemen should suf al gabe yayin. What happens if you have oil and wine mixed together? Of course, the oil will float. Now, and then that oil, which is separated with a very clear line of distinction, if the oil is separated, v'naga tful yom b'shemen, and then a tful yom, this person has gone to the mikvah, but they're not going to be tahor until dark. And during that interim period, they touch the oil, which is floating on top of the wine. How does that impact the wine? I'm a tvul yom. I went to the mikvah already, but it's not dark out. And I reach over and I touch the oil on the top of your wine. What does that do? So says the Gemara, the Tanakhama writes, lo pasal el shemen bilvad. We separate the oil from the wine. Namely, wine and oil do not mix. Rav Yochanan ben Nuri Omer, no. Shnei en chiburan zelazeh. Even though it's true that one's oil and one's water, and even though it's true they have a very clear distinction as they are mixed because the oil will float to the top, still it is going to be considered a mixture. Rabbanan ki Rabbanan, Rav Shimon ki Rav Yochanan ben Nuri. This fits perfectly with our Mishnah. And if you were to look back in our Mishnah, you'd see that the Tanakhama, who says that oil and water tzrichin la'arev, they hold like the Tanakhama over here on Ayin Aleph Amud Beis, who says that the Tvul Yom who touches the oil, he's only metame the oil, but the wine is fine. Because our Tanakhama and the Rabbanan here say wine and oil don't mix. Masha'en Kein Rav Shimon in our Mishnah, who says that you do not need an Eruv when you have oil and water, that shows you that oil and water mix. And if oil and water mix, then you can have an Eruv, and it fits perfectly and beautifully. And that's Rabbanan ki Rabbanan, v'Rav Shimon k'Rav Yochanan ben Nuri. And then Tanya, we have another Braisa that adds in still another Shita, something that we didn't see in our Mishnah. This is why we need Braisas. This Braisa is critical. It adds another layer to our Mishnah that we didn't have. Tanya, the Braisa writes six lines down, Ayin Aleph Amud Beis. Rav Elazar ben Tadoy Omer, Echad zeh, ve'echad zeh, tzrich in la'arev, l'chumra, the other way. Even if it's all wine, nobody entertained that option in our Mishnah. In our Mishnah, the only machlokas was what happened when you had a wine and oil mixture. So then the Tanakhama said it doesn't work. And then the Rav Shimon said it does work for Eruv. However, here we see that l'chumra, you always need to have an Eruv, even if it's wine and wine. So says the Gemara, v'afilu lazeh b'yayin, v'lazeh b'yayin, why? Why? It's all the same liquid. It's perfect, says the Gemara. Amar Rabba. Rabba explains. Zeba bilagenu v'shafach. V'zeba bilagenu v'shafach. Let's say you and I are neighbors, and each of us bring our part of the Eruv, and we dump it into the barrel separate. I have my amount, you have your amount, we dump it into the barrel. That kule alma lo pligi de have Eruv. That's pashut that works. And that's not the case of Rav Tadoy. But rather, where is the machlok? That's one third of the way down. Ki pligi. The machlokes that we have here with Rav Tadoy is kipligi is kigon shalachu chavis shel yain b'shutfes. No, I didn't bring my wine and you brought yours. You and I together bought a barrel, and we wanted to be ma'arev with it. So what's the machlokes there? Why is it that some say it's mutter and some say it's not? Says the Gemara beautifully. Reb Elazar ben Tadoy savar ein breira. We don't know which droplets of wine, which molecules belong to me, which molecules belong to you. And because he doesn't hold a breira, so we don't allow this future projection of what wine belongs to whom, and therefore the Eruv doesn't work. Masha'enken v'rabbanan savre yesh breira. And because the Rabbanan hold that there's breira, so therefore, no problem at all. We do allow for that to count as an Eruv. Rav Yosef Amar, Rav Yosef gives a different explanation of the machlokes. Rav Elazar ben Tadoy v'Rabbanan, Rav Elazar ben Tadoy and the Rabbanan were arguing about something else. They were not arguing about whether or not there's breira. They were arguing about this somchen al shituf b'makom eruv kamiflage. Let's say that you made your shitufei mavos. You did what you needed to do for the mavui, but you forgot to do the eruv chatzeros. Do we have an interdependency between the shitufei mavos and eruv chatzeros? So says the Gemara, that's what this machlokes is about. B'somchen al shituf b'makom eruv kamiflage. D'mar savar eim somchen. That's the shituf Rav Tadoy. We say that if you only did shituf mavos, but not eruv, then that does not work, even if it's wine and wine. Umar Savar Somchen, the Rabbanan hold that yes, we do say that Shituf Mukos works in the place of Eruv Chatzeros, and therefore the yain would work. How does Rav Yosef know that this is the Machlokes, that it's about whether we're Somchen Shituf B'makom Eruv? Amar Rav Yosef, halfway down, the Na'aminola, how do we know that the Machlokes between Rav Tadoy and the Rabbanan is about whether or not we extend the successful Shituf Mukos that we did to a scenario where one forgot to be Ma'arev? Amar Rav Yehuda Amar Rav, because Rav Yehuda Amar Rav says halacha kireb meir. We don't know what halacha kireb meir means yet. We're going to learn this tomorrow, but we'll just cheat and look at Rashi. Rashi one inch. Rashi says halacha. Let's go back up one. Says Rashi, how do we know that this, that what Rav Yosef is talking about, the link between Shituf Mubos and Eruv Chatzeros, is what Rav Tadoy and the Rabbanan are arguing about? Because it says halacha kireb meir. What does Rav Meir hold? Dein somchen al shituf b'makom eruv. That's one shituf. Amar Rav Baruna, Amar Rav, and Rav had a second statement also. First, he said we don't hold like Rav Meir, and that we hold like Rav Meir. And the second thing he said is that the halacha is kireb elazar ben Tadoy.
That's Gemara. I'm going to the bathroom.
My time. Why would you say the same exact thing twice? You said we hold like Rav Meir, who holds that there's shituf b'makom avui. And then we hold that ain't somchen al shituf b'makom avui. And we hold that Rav Tadoy holds the same way. So says the Gemara, lav mishum isn't it because both Rav Meir and Rav Tadoy have the same nucleus, which is that they say that shituf mavos, the dependency of shituf mavos with Eruv Chatzeros. Abaye, what are you talking about? V'chad taimahu, if there's all the same reason, tarte hilcha salamo. Then why do I need Rav to teach me the same thing twice? You told me we hold like Rav Meir and like Rav Tadoy. If they're both saying the same thing, then don't give me both of them. So says the Gemara, an answer that will remain a little cryptic. I don't know if there are cryptic. But if there were to be one, it would be this kind of line. This is to say that we don't paskin the chumras of Rav Meir in Eruvin. And tomorrow we're going to see what the second chumra was. And one is that we don't allow us to rely on Shituf Muvos as it then extends to the world of Eruv Chatzeros. And right here is where we will pick up tomorrow with my Rav Meir. Wishing you all a beautiful day.